So today again we continue our further study on the analytical solutions. So with as I told last time that we will take up J2 where we made some improvement on the earlier analytical solution, and then I will enter into the drag, atmospheric drag, which is very important for the near earth satellites. So today we have we will remember Professor Dirk Brouwer, one of the greatest mathematician and astronomer, under whose name that Brouwer Award has been instituted. He didn't live a long life, 64 years, but the kind of work he has done shows how much he could achieve in that age of 64. This has been, I got it from the net. This is written by, this biographical memoir is written by J.M. Clemens. You may be knowing, he has a famous book by Brouwer and Clemens. So same Clemens, yes, J.M. Clemens, yes, he's written about him. And this was published in National Academy of Sciences, copyright. It is there. Anyway, we are trying to only see here. So they are telling any opinion expressed in this memoir are those of author and do not necessarily reflect the views of National Academy of Sciences. Dirk Brouwer, who contributed more to dynamical astronomy than any other astronomer of his time, died on January 31, and today is also January 31 is the day when he passed away. You can say 66 or 45 years. It is how much? 55 years after a week in hospital. His death was occasioned by an acute disorder of the heart. He survived by his wife, widow, and an only son, James. Brouwer was born in Rotterdam in the Netherlands on September 1, 1902, the son of a civil service employee. As a student in the University of Leiden, he studied mathematics and astronomy, coming under the influence of William D. Sitter, who in his own days was the dean of that branch of astronomy in which Brouwer was to do most of his work. Receiving the PhD degree in 1927 under D. Sitter, Brouwer came to United States as a fellow of the International Education Board, spending a year at the University of California in Berkeley and at Yale University, where he was to remain the rest of his life. So Yale University made his permanent home. His initial appointment at Yale was in 1928 as a research assistant to Ernest W. Brown. You see, Brown theory we know, who was then the greatest living authority on the motion of the moon. After rising through the usual junior ranks in 1941, he was appointed professor, chairman of the Department of Astronomy and director of the observatory. And in 1944, Mersenne professor of natural philosophy and astronomy, post which he held until his death. Also in 1941, when the American Astronomical Society acquired ownership of the astronomical journal, Brouwer was appointed editor. You see the kind of the honor and the authority he was given, and later senior editor. That was the best journal in the area of celestial mechanics. Another post he held until his death. He was elected to the National Academy of Sciences in 1951 and was awarded the gold medal of the Royal Astronomical Society in 1955. Among his other honors were George Darwin Lecture, Fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Science, Correspondent of the Royal Netherlands Academy, Honorary Doctor of the University of La Plata, and corresponding member of the Academy of Sciences at Buenos Aires. He was also awarded the Bruce Medal of Astronomical Society of the Pacific, the decision among taken a month before his death, and the actual award being made posthumously. Brouwer was the author, jointly with the writer, of a successful book. Yeah, that book I was talking, Methods of Celestial Mechanics. One of the earliest book, you see, Danby wrote in 62. His book, but this book was much more detailed book, and some of the research also he has contributed to this book, which has also been published in a Russian translation. He was active in the International Astronomical Union, serving 6 years as president of the Commission on Asteroids and Comets, 6 years as president of the Commission on Celestial Mechanics, as chairman of a working group on photographic astronometry, and as a member of a working group on the system of astronomical constants. The subject of dynamical astronomy or celestial mechanics traditionally comprises the study of the motion of planets and satellites. In any particular case, the aim is to develop mathematical expressions that will yield the coordinates of the body in question as functions of the time, such that substitution of any value of time, past or future, will yield the whereabouts of the body. Obviously, this aim is not attainable until knowledge of the beginning and end of the solar system is available. Hence, in practice, it is attempted to solve the problem of the span of years during which a body has been observed, and to project the work as far into the future as it is practicable, which in ordinary cases is some centuries. The study of motion within a cluster of stars or within a galaxy is also included in dynamical astronomy, but this subject also become prominent only since 1950. Brouwer declined to interest himself in it, saying that there was plenty for him to do in the field that he knew something about. Indispensable adjunct of classical dynamical astronomy in astrometry, which includes the determination of accurate position and motions of some tens of thousands of stars, to which in turn the position of planets and satellites may be referred. Brouwer was early introduced to astrometry by Frank Schillingranger, his predecessor as director of the Yale Observatory. He devised and practiced new techniques in the field, and Brouwer never ceased to do all he could on the theoretical side of the advancement of the subject. Following Schillingranger's death, he also gave active support to the continuation of the Schillingranger's astrometric program until his own death. Brouwer's most important contribution to dynamical astronomy are as follows. He and W.J. Eckert devised a new scheme for the differential correction of orbits of planets and satellites, in which the differential coefficients are derived from the latest approximation to the orbit in the simplest possible way, with a minimum of calculation. The method is now used almost exclusively throughout the world. He showed that in the numerical integration of orbits, the errors in 5 of the 6 parameters increase proportionally to the square root of the number of steps of integration, whereas the error of the 6th, the position in the orbit, increases with the 3/2 power of the number of steps. He devised a plan for eliminating the systematic errors of the star catalogs of position by means of selected minor planets. He developed a new form of planetary theory in which the use of rectangular coordinates is made to yield analytic expressions of the utmost elegance and simplicity. He established a definite correction between Encke's comet and the torrid group of meteors. With W.J. Eckert and the writer, he calculated precise values of the coordinates of the 5 outer planets for more than 400 years. This work, the first extensive application of the high-speed calculating machines to the subject, is still the standard of comparison for all similar work done since. See, that's a great thing. But anyway, he wrote long back. He established that the fluctuations in the rate of rotation of the Earth are of a statistical character, and that would be produced by random disturbances in the interior of the earth, and in 1950 he proposed the name ephemeris time, which has been adopted throughout the world for the astronomical measure of time that is free from such fluctuations. He solved the problem of the effect of the oblateness of the earth on the motion of our satellites. This was the one where I was very much interested when I got hold of his paper. This solution of great practical value as well as theoretical interest is completely general and immediately applicable to any satellite. Very general way he did the research. He solved the problem of the existence of the Kirkwood gaps in the ring of minor planets, which is another important problem, which had baffled astronomers for half a century. In mentioning his most important contributions, I limit myself arbitrarily to 10. In fact, there are many others that are hardly less important than these, although administrative or financial affairs did not interest him as a rule. He could be actively enough when he thought the occasion required it. The most notable case in point was the construction, after almost a decade of persistent effort, of a twin astrographic telescope with the aid of the Ford Foundation at the Yale Columbia Southern Observatory for the purpose of completing the extragalactic survey that had been undertaken for the northern sky by the Lick Observatory. He lived to see the first year of the active operation of the new instrument undertaken with the aid of the National Science Foundation. The launching in 1957 of the first artificial satellite soon led to an upsurge of interest in dynamical astronomy to an extent unprecedented in the history of the subject. In the immediately preceding decades, the number of active workers in the field had been about 6 in the United States, with perhaps a slightly greater number in the rest of the world. Now, within the single year, scores of students were seized with the desire to study dynamical astronomy, and the demand for teachers of the subject far exceeded the supply. In part, the demand for generated by government laboratories having responsibility for tracking space vehicles, but more important seemed to have been the general public interest in space activities. The Yale Department of Astronomy had many more prospective graduate students applying for admission than it could accommodate. Brouwer conceived the idea of creating a summer institute in dynamical astronomy, afterwards popularly known as SIDA, consisting of an intensive 6-week course of lectures, 4 or 5 daily, which would be open to college teachers and to employees of industry and government with the aid of National Science Foundation. 6 such institutes were held before his death, and they were widely acclaimed. In this summer institute, once Professor R.K. Chaudhary also had attended this summer institute. With a view of the more distant future, Brouwer envisaged an institute on celestial mechanics at Yale, which would consist of a small resident faculty, visiting lecturers, and graduate students, with the aid of the Office of Naval Research and the Air Force Office of Scientific Research. The institute was created in 1962 and is still flourishing. These two educational activities demonstrate that Brouwer's power of innovation was by no means limited to his own research. One of his most notable personal attributes was absolute integrity. His word was always his bond in small matters as well as great ones. Several times I knew him to decline to be released from obligations that must have been onerous, even when the circumstances in which they were made had been substantially altered. He was also exceedingly persevering, an example that his study of the English language, which he continued unremittingly to the very end of his life, although in English was better than that of most Native Americans. For more than 20 years, he asked me to criticize nearly everything he published for grammar, rhetoric, and style. And when we were together, he often requested me to justify the form of something I had said or written. He disciplined himself to speak without notes, and most of his lectures were models of clarity and logical development. Usually he had a book or two with him, but would refer to them only at rare intervals. He had an engaging custom while at the blackboard of giving emphasis to his remarks by jabbing vigorously with the chalk when it broke, which was often he habitually caught the flying piece in midair without obvious exertion. It seems to fall into his hand. He claimed to have no application of the fine arts and indeed to be unable to distinguish two musical pitches unless they were nearly half an octave apart. But he would sit cheerfully through musical performances or visit art galleries when the amenities seemed required. And he was always ready with a graceful comment afterwards. He was nearly always cheerful, even tempered, energetic, and active, very seldom ill, never moving slowly, but always anxious to get to the pending items of business. His principal exercise consisting of walking, moving to lawn, and shoveling snow, all of which he did vigorously. He had nothing I would call a hobby, although he enjoyed watching an occasional game of baseball or soccer, and he could usually report the relative standing in Major League Baseball at a moment's notice. He was also compensate among his most disagreeable duties were flunking a student and rejecting a manuscript, which he always did as gently as possible, often at considerable cost of his own time. With the dishonesty, evasion, and malfeasance, he had no patience. I saw his wrath break out on two occasions, and I am sure the miscreants never forgot it. So that is what Professor Clement wrote about him. And this is, he has given, you know, the full biography of this. So from 1924 onwards, so I thought that let it be there so that it can be useful if some people are interested to see his this thing. But later half papers are quite useful too when he worked on the area of the celestial mechanics. See, the first paper itself is a new determination of the mass of Titan by Hill's method. New determination of the mass of Titan by Hill's method. Titan is the satellite of the biggest satellite of Saturn, and there that is his one of the first paper which he did in 1924, very young age. So these are all there, which I have recorded here, and so that you could feel those which are useful. One can have a see with these things we get motivation that such people were there in a small short life. He has achieved so much and became. And his name will ever remain. Rovers award, getting more Rovers award in the area of the celestial mechanics and the area is not an easy task. It's a very difficult task. Even Zabe got much later. So Brown, see, these are some of his papers. So I had taken the whole thing. I was thinking whether to use it, take or I said, okay, let it be recorded. So see the remarks on the theories of Uranus and Neptune, correction in the compilation and discussion of occultation. So this is he has given very here the patience, you know, he has written patience to cover take all his publications and wrote them year wise here. They do not publish so many in 1 year, but what they publish is something great. See, this paper is just system mechanics. This is a review kind of this thing. But maybe you might have written something great here. A new discussion on the changes in the Earth's rate of rotation. The polar motion and change in the Earth's orbit. With the Clemens, he has written the motion of the 5 outer planets, circular variations of the orbital elements of minor planets, and gradually when the things, then he started written there after 1957 when the first Russian satellite went into orbit, then he has changed himself. See, he wrote six system mechanics again, one paper here, and then you can see here some of the papers which he has written. Solution of the problem of artificial satellite theory without drag. This is a very important work which he carried out on the von Zippel methods he used, and then he has found out a very good solution. Theoretical evaluation of atmospheric drag effects. Because nearer satellites, you know, with drags are important. Without drag, they die because of atmospheric drag. Theoretical evaluation of atmospheric drag effects in motion of artificial astronomical journal he published with Hori. Hori, another Japanese, yeah, they were working there. I think he has carried out some of the work. Analytical study of resonance caused by solar radiation pressure. Solar radiation pressure also, he worked on this also. Motion of the moon in space. So different kind of, you know, work he has carried out, and that is how 66 anyway he died, very young age, very young age for such a person of great problem of Kirkwood gaps in the asteroid belt. This problem was very important. Canonical treatment of dissipative forces. So this is another breakthrough works. So this is how we remember a great man in the history of celestial mechanics. So this again, we come back to the one last time I was telling you that I integrated the equations analytically. We could get the integrals, but the approximation was that the radial distance r was assumed to be r is equal to a into 1 minus e cos e, where a is semi-major axis, e is eccentricity, and capital E is the eccentric anomaly. It's a very convenient expression without oblateness. But then r is also a function of oblateness j2. So then one of my students, Dr. Harish, he was doing PhD with KS elements, and then one of the student undergraduate doing a project. So now she works in Team Indus. So we started this work. Together we started this work because King Haley written a wonderful paper in, even then King Haley is known for the work on atmospheric drag. But then these great people, you know, they have worked in other areas as well. So he worked with oblateness, a very good paper in 1958, published in Proceedings of Royal Society of London. So that paper somehow I got the copy of that. And there we could see an expression of R, which was function of J2. He has taken, so I thought that is where we are able to use that R, instead of we take R is equal to A into 1 minus E cos E, if we include the J2 effect also, certainly some improvement we will make on our solution. The idea is, you see, still we can make more as you improve upon, because other parameters are okay. We have integrated analytically exact integrals, so solutions are okay. But if we are able to, because R is coming in denominator in various powers, if we are able to integrate that also analytically, able to find some good integrals and able to model this R as accurately as possible as function of obliteness, then certainly the solutions improve. And this J2 solution is always required for a short term or because during, as I told you, that during a revolution, there are oscillations, which we are and oscillating and mean elements I was discussing, you know, earlier in the earlier part of the lecture series. There I had told you that the J, without J, actually J2 gives us, and then where, you know, Dr. Bhatnagar and Dr. Takvi's paper, which was also with J2, taking the for circle near circular orbits, where they had taken the terms up to higher, the J2 square terms to mean the quadratic terms in eccentricity, they were taken, not J2 square. Then it improved substantially. And later on, when these maxima, etc., were available to us, we extended that work to E4 terms, and improvement was obtained there. Okay. Because these are required for getting the the location there of the satellite as a function of the J2, and that is J2 is the one by which you are you don't get a smooth orbit. You will be always some kind of the changes will be there in the radial distance. It won't be showing you a passing over a ellipse or over a circle or over any other conic. So this one we wait Sharma's singularity free analytical theory for short term orbit motion with Earth in terms of case element in closed form, because the expression which I obtained was in eccentricity and in terms of eccentricity and inclination as well. With our zonal harmonic J2 is improved using King Halley's expression for the radial distance r, which includes the effect of J2. It is suitable for low eccentricity orbits. It may be useful when we take little more. One more term was there here, but that was giving too many terms. Maybe if we take that, probably some more improvement may be observed. So numerical experiments we carried out, and then I'll show you with different orbits. So this is okay. We have reviewed some of the important contributions. These are all important. Brouwer, Kozai, these are all important papers which we have reviewed over here. Garfinkel, another good paper. Arxnes did a good work. And then we had, so these are all the ones which we already I obtained these, and this is the state vector. As I told you, we do only one, though we have to do 8 numerically, but we handle only one of the equations. As I told you, the technique, only that expression comes in because of the trigonometric cos by E by 2 and sin E by 2, we are able to write them in terms of this kind of expressions, and that helps us to the write them in this form. And so this is similarly this is an extension of the last paper which I presented in the last lecture. Now how did we do with the King Halley's expression? So King Halley's expression we had taken, you see J2, you can see now we have written 1 by, we need 1 by r and 1 by like that, those things. So this is written, L is 1 a into 1 minus e square, and this is the term which we have taken. This is the one which you need. J2 is here. Now it's a function of the J2, and that we have to push now in our theory. And now we tried, now we knew how to do it, but the expressions were longer. Converting them into case elements, that we gradually we did. Whatever terms were required, we did them. You can we have shown them. 1 by r cube is written in this fashion, and where J2s are there. So because these are all required, if you don't put J2, then this expression we have already obtained those integrals. But with this into these integrals we have to evaluate now. Even then the contribution will be small, but well, that is what the improvement we wanted to see. Here also we had to get the integrals, and we felt we will get. So these whatever terms are there, we wrote them. And you can see now, this says that the other fellow has become now much more bigger. This is alpha 0 because we are writing alpha I varying from 1 to 8. And once we know one of them, then only initial condition need to be changed. So it will pass through a do loop and I is equal to 1 to 2 like that up to 8 it will go and calculate delta alpha 1, delta alpha 2, delta alpha 3, delta alpha 4 and others are beta 1, beta 2, beta 3 and like that. So these are all the integrals. Whatever integrals we needed, we were able to get them. See, these kind of integrals are also coming. We have defined, you know, this will be defined like this. Lambda PRS will be integral cos raised to power of PE sine raised to power SE 1 minus EQ raised to power of Q. So these are all the integrals which we took some effort we had to take, but well, my student was there, two both of them were there, with three were there, so we were able to get them. So these are all the bigger ones which we obtained. Others are okay, these are all the coefficients. So the numerical integration we carried out for four cases. Now we can see there the numerical integration, the new method, the one which where we have taken J2 into consideration in R. These are the terms. This is calculated in one step in analytical. That is half revolution we did. That means you go, you are there at the perigee, say at the perigee, and you are reaching at different places. But numerical means numerically you are going accurately by 1 degree or so, whichever is more accurate. 1 degree was sufficient here, which gives you, even if you go half degree at 1 degree, there will be no difference in the numbers. That's how we find the 1 degree is sufficient. Or even if you, so you can see this is the improvement now. Numerical minus analytical. This is the error left. See, what are these errors are still left. And this error was there earlier theory. So there you can see some improvement you can see here. Everywhere there won't be improvement. Say there we did not see at 150. They are of the similar order, but there was a small this thing. And now, but most of the places we have seen that we with the new expressions, some places you see we have this much improvement has come. The error even after 60 degree is only 8 meters. And like that. So that is how we evaluated there the new theory. With small step size, because you see when you go with the larger step size analytically in one step you are going. So some of the oscillations you are not being there. So the previous values, whatever you use, you are having all the previous one. So they will not go properly. We have no other way. When you are taking a larger step size, you are taking the initial value, the previous value. So they will also contribute to your errors. That is how the errors, when you do numerically, your errors do not come. Because you are using the previous value and your step size is only say 1 degree or half degree or so. So those all, as whatever oscillations are there in the solution, everything is you are capturing. But you cannot capture here all the things. That is how the errors also. And sometimes this kind of thing also is contributed because of that. But well, we saw the improvement that the J2 term with R2 has given us. And see, some of the time when we have an arc, you know, when a rocket goes in space, so for some time it remains in coasting orbit. Coasting means the rocket will not use the power at that time. So that time, The most of the motion is with their Earth's oblateness will be certainly playing a role. So, and short periodic terms due to that. At that time, these kind of expressions could be useful. Because you don't get, you are in 30 degrees, in case less than this, these errors will be less than that, surely. So your errors, you know, the second method gave 7, but here it gave only 0.4. 0.8, 1 point and like that. So there is a application to this thing. And this is where we have shown there difference between major axis, between modified and existing. What is the differences are coming? Because they will come sometime, the oscillations are sometime negative side, positive sides. So this is the kind of, the differences we note between the two theories. This is for the semi-major axis, and this is for the eccentricity, and this is for the inclination, and this is for the, these three parameters are the one which are more affected by the atmospheric drag. So this is how the, I mean not atmospheric, by J2 terms. Others are also there, but we have selected these three parameters for our detailed study. So this is how this work was completed. And conclusion was the modified non-singular theory with analytical solution for short-term motion. This is for short-term motion. But from here, you know, we can get long-term also. The same, because this expression contains the entire thing. Here itself, we can bifurcate them into short-term, the terms which are having secular, etc. Because this gives the all everything. From here, we can identify those terms as well also. The study showed that with the inclusion of the perturbed R by King Haley, the accuracy of solution increases significantly in some places. These results are documented for half an evaluation. An acknowledgement, because Dr. Harish was getting, because this is a project we had from DST, so we have given the acknowledgement to, because we are supposed to give acknowledgement to Department of Space, surrender that we got. We were doing this, so this also work comes under that thing. And some of these important references are there. Brewer solution of, we have discussed in Brewer solution of problem of artificial satellite theory without drag. So there he discusses. He takes up to J5, J2, J3, J4, advanceable method. It is a very, very wonderful paper. And one can get a lot of, and from, though people were using that to generate the mean elements for a long time. Diprit has done one very good method, elimination of parallax in satellite theory. This was a wonderful work which Diprit has done. Karfinkel also very good work. This is also, and Gurfield, Lara, they were checking this Diprit's theory, radial intermediary, for their work. So you see, we also try to discuss this when we were doing one other work with Dr. Harish. We were doing Kozai, another great man who has done a lot of work in the thing. And this is the one, you know, the where Kustanima and Stifel, this is a person who was expert in the number theory. And they found out that KS element, this is the paper, perturbation theory of Kepler. I have the paper also. Those days when I asked them, I think probably they sent me. Stifel, I think, has sent me the paper. Perturbation theory of Kepler motion based on spinor regularization. From somewhere I located this paper. Now it's difficult to get online, difficult to get. But anyway, I had that time. So this is Stifel's book. Now we come to this. So this is the work which I carried out. I was invited to deliver an invited talk in Goswar. And then I asked my boss, Dr. Subbarao, what should I do? Shall I take up the work of whatever we have done and present as this thing, or shall I do something new? He says it's better if you could do something new. Then I thought, okay, in case variable, let me try to develop a new theory. So this work was initiated by that. You can see here, there is an error here. This N is extra. When I was checking the proof, I forgot to see my name, and so this name has gone wrong. So this has been cited 28 times, but because if people work, then it might get a better citation. So this is the work which was my first paper in the Royal Society of London, and it was quickly published. So here again, you see how we did it. I'll skip the introduction. The equations now, we are taking now perturbed potential. See where the KS element, the equations are written. You have both V and P. So a J2 kind of forces can go in V and drag kind of forces can go in P. So when we are taking only the drag, so this V will not come. These forces will not come. So equations will become simplified. they will become simplified. And for drag, when we these are all the basic things which I wrote. And when we wrote, when we take only the before, these are all the initial, earlier also I showed, these are the initial, how to get the initial conditions. You know only position velocity, how to get the those case initialization of those variables. With this, we can get those things. Now, these are the ones. Now, when we take only P, now those equations become now this much. Now, the problem was, it was not an easy task. It was a difficult task because P, J3, J4 by that time I had done, but this force has to be modeled now, this drag, and it contains the velocity also, velocity. So we knew about the forces because we were calculating lifetime and other thing, and because of practical problems we were handling. So we had good knowledge about the P, but then how to handle it analytically here was the task. Well, some effort I had to make because I had to generate in terms of theory. So I'm sharing what I that time I had the problems. So it was not very easy. So I knew density we can write with an oblate atmosphere because this is King Ali's expression. King Ali's book was there with us. So this is there. So density at any place in the atmosphere you can write in terms of the eccentric anomaly and the argument of perigee of that orbit. So like that you can write, and these are the drag parameters. Some of the this is the perigee, and like that some of the parameters are there. This is an oblate rotating atmosphere. This was fine. This was no problem. Problem was to write in terms of the velocity. Now velocity V was coming. So this I have written it. So after a lot of efforts, though it looks simple, but it took a lot of time for me with discussing with some friend, because there is nobody as such with whom I can discuss more detailed. But anyway, some of my other friends were there with whom. So finally, I reached to this, that V velocity I was having there, I wrote in terms of this. And that's all, because I need eccentric anomaly. The entire equations are in terms of eccentric anomaly. So this was the important step, which removed all my hurdles. And then once this was there, then things were become simpler. And I was able to write and then put this. These are the final experiments, because these are Royal Society papers. So all the things we are not writing. But then this, and they became, very symmetrical form. They came over here. And this is the change in energy. See here, with the drag, energy will change. And when we take J2, this d omega dw by d change in energy, this will be zero. So time we were finding out. Here, what I said is, time we will not bother, because drag is a force where a lot of uncertainties will be there. So we calculate semi-major axis, and then semi-major axis will use to you find out the time. Because we use Kepler's third law, and from there we'll find out the time. So we will not handle that equation. So we handled this equation, and we handled the that other equation. And these are the, see, there is in drag, there is a called integral representation of the ballistic function of the first kind and of imaginary argument. So when my paper when I came back, it was accepted as it is. The only thing they said is, you have not written imaginary here. So imaginary was to be only written, but otherwise nothing was asked to revise. That was something which my friends or my bosses, they said how that happened. It happened anyway, I do not know. So imaginary was the one which they said, maybe I might have forgotten to write this imaginary, first kind of imaginary. Maybe normally we will never forget this imaginary argument, but somehow. So that was the only comment there while accepting the paper. And these are the eight, only these initial conditions to be changed. And when these kind of expressions come there, we can write in terms of modified beta. And they are very accurate when we calculate them. their values come very accurate. So that is that was known already in the which we were already using. So my this fellow became in terms of those modified Bessel functions. This is the change in energy, and then the other one, the other thing was the next hurdle was here. Now my d alpha 1 by de, you can see this comes like this. Now p1, p2, p3, these fellows are coming. Now I worked each one carefully. When I worked each one carefully, I was greatly happy that everything comes in this form, which I needed when I was working with J2. Because you here e by 2, sine e by 2, cos e by 2 comes, then you multiply by sine e by 2, cos e by 2. So 2 sine e by 2, cos e by 2 will give sine e, and 1 cos square, when one sine square e by 2 will, that will come, that will be again become cos e minus 1. So that way this thing, this fellow, this these things came. So this that is how I could club all the 8, I mean only the initial condition what to be changed, but everything could be written similarly. Alpha 2 could be written in this form, say only in initial. So this was the only trick which to be needed here. Otherwise, you have to solve 6 equations in Lagrange predicate. And these theories are not having any singularities. We do not have down any I or E or equal to 0 or I equal to 0. So this is the one for a state vector. So you are working with position velocities. So this is the one which came. Now we knew the when you integrate them, you get in terms of the modified Bessel functions and their values, you see. This so these are all these integrals, you know, they are all available. Again we use here R, but in this case it is not a major problem, because drag does not give much perturbation to R. So R is equal to A into 1 minus E cos E. We use in drag problem, it will not make much inaccuracies. That is the that because it doesn't contain much short periodic terms due to the track. These are all the things. They are all hand done. You know, those is there no. We did not had the this Maxima Mathematica the softwares. So we all everything done by hand, and then the I took up took. Because already we knew how to do the numerical simulations. By that time, we have already experienced our calculations with the numerically with the case elements. So I took 6 cases, starting with very small eccentricity, and these are their perigee apogees. So different kind of orbits, you know, you will get the eccentricity very small and up to 0.1. So 0.1 gives you where perigee distance is 328 and apogee is 1121. So mostly the most of the drag, atmospheric drag, there can be perigee can be low, but these are good representation for checking the analytical expressions. So these 6 cases were properly chosen, and I kept I to be 1, but well, it is not was not going to make a major difference when you even if you take another I, small differences will be certainly there. These parameter won't make much difference, capital omega and small omega. And mean anomaly, every time I have started from the perigee. And then these are all the details are written here, how those things were there. Now you can see here, the semi-major axis. After you can see that revolution in this column. After one revolution, we have checked with numerical. Numerical you assume to be the accurate, because we have carried out only with 1 degree of integration, so they are accurate. And analytical you can see here now when you do after one revolution, you see in almost in all cases you are able to reproduce the numerical result. So you get this is kilometer, this is you can see, you know, up to centimeter, millimeter, etc. Even better than that you get here, because this is there, then meter comes here, and then centimeter, 2 centimeter, small difference only come in that level. And similarly, you can see after 10 revolutions, 25 revolutions, 50 revolutions, 100 revolutions. So numerical you can assume to be the correct. So this is the kind of thing which happens. that's not major. Normally we don't do for 100 revolution as such, but even if we do, we are not paying a heavy penalty. So this is how we, as because this is a very very, it's a highly circular orbit. Circular orbits, the forces will be more, you can see. So over the this much decay, this much difference is only there. So this is how we made the check over this semi-major axis, and eccentricity also came quite well. See, after one revolution, not much difference. You can see there, the differences are very small. Even after 100 revolutions, you see 5 degrees. I mean, the differences are not. I mean, here there differences are going. So this was tested for these 6 cases, and this is the perigee. See, the argument of perigee with atmospheric drag also changes. So this also we were able to capture. You see, after one revolution, we are almost able to do every calculation. And you see, after 100 revolution, this much change has come in small omega. That means plane has rotated by drag also. See, with the oblateness, it rotates. We know secular perturbations there. But here also secular perturbations are happening. But the order will be small. There it is much more. So this is the numerical value and this is the analytical value. So this much accurately we are able to get this. So this is how the drag in terms of KS. So this was the first theory in terms of drag in terms of KS variables. And then because I was invited to deliver by Professor Sehnal, he was also a great man, Sehnal, to deliver an invited lecture on atmospheric drag effects and descent trajectory in the COSPAR planetary meeting to be held in Hague, Netherlands. But I missed it narrowly. I mean, almost my name was cleared from the center, but somehow I missed it. Maybe finance or other problems sometime happen. So, but then I thought that since I worked so hard, I must send it some good place, and got a courage to send it to the Royal Society, because it is not, you have to get a courage also to get sent to Royal Society. So that was the first courage I got, and I was successful also. And this was my director who cleared my visit also at that time. But it goes to headquarters, chairman has to also clear and find funds and other things. And he was my deputy director and he was my head. So he was my group director. And so this is some of the my bosses whom I thanked. So thanks to my colleagues, they helped, you know, some of my friends who helped me while I was doing this study. So I thank them. And then you can see, these are the references. King Haley's book. This is a wonderful book. King Haley's book, which now I don't have this book here, because in VSSC I was having this book, Satellite Theory and Atmosphere. It's a very costly book, around 21,000 rupees it costs. And so we have not purchased this book in my project. So this is also, Cook also is a good worker, as I told earlier. And then some of my references are there. We were asked, as I told, you know, we were asked earlier to tabulate them, the results in our report. Internal report. So this was made as internal report, and you see how quickly it was. Even then, everything was by mail. You know, there was no email, nothing. So all by going by letters, and then see received. They received on 13th August 1990, and they accepted on 5th November. So it was this is one of the earliest it was accepted, because somebody else, the people who evaluate also are, maybe King Haley himself, maybe one of the evaluator here, because one place I know he told that he indirectly, he just said so there I could understand. So here also he might be there, one of the, because they only evaluate Royal Society. When you send, they will be the people who will evaluate your papers. So this paper I made it. And with that, okay, we are able to do it today's thing. Even then, we missed some of our time because of the computer problem. So this is the thing.